Hello students, now we are going to learn the new lesson in biobotany, fourth lesson, reproductive morphology. We will learn about the different types of inflorescence. Differentiate between racemous and cymous inflorescence. We will explore the parts of a flower. We will learn about the different types of aestivation, different types of placentation, types of fruits and seeds, and we will also differentiate dicot and monocot seeds. We exchange flowers as a mark of respect, affection, happiness, etc. Flowers helps the plant to reproduce its own kind. Floriculture. Floriculture is a branch of horticulture that deals with the cultivation of flowers and ornamental crops. We export these flowers. Floriculture is now 100% export oriented. Agriculture and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority APEDA is responsible for the export promotion of agricultural and horticultural products from India. Have you seen a bouquet? Bouquet will have group of flowers arranged according to our preference. But what is an inflorescence? Inflorescence is a group of flowers arising from a branched or unbranched axis of the plant, and they will have the flowers arranged in a definite pattern. What is the function of the inflorescence? The inflorescence helps to display the flowers for effective pollination and facilitate seed dispersal. Grouping of flowers in one place will give a better attraction for the visiting pollinating organisms. What are the different types of inflorescence? Based on the position of the inflorescence, they are classified into three types. First one, terminal. The inflorescence grow at the terminal part of the shoot. The plant terminal end will bear this inflorescence. Example, raceme of Nerium oleander. The second type is called as axillary. In axillary, the inflorescence will be present at the axil of the nearest vegetative leaf. The plant bears the flowers at the axil of a leaf. Example, Hibiscus rosa sinensis. The third type is called as cauliflorus. Here, the inflorescence develops directly from the woody trunk. The trunk of the tree will bear the inflorescence. Example for cauliflorus, the inflorescence that is developing from the woody trunk, Theobroma coca. Other examples, jackfruit and cannonball tree. Based on the branching pattern and other characters, the inflorescence may be classified into four types, namely indeterminate, that is racemose inflorescence, determinate, that is cymose inflorescence, mixed inflorescence, which is the combination of indeterminate as well as determinate pattern, and some special inflorescence. They will not be confined to any of the above patterns. So here we can see the diagram of racemose and cymose. The first one is the racemose. So in this, the older flowers will be at the bottom, and the main axis, the inflorescence axis, the central axis of the inflorescence, that is a peduncle, will possess the terminal bud, which is capable of growing continuously, and they will produce a lateral buds, and so it is called as racemose inflorescence. In the second type, which is the cymose inflorescence, the central axis will stop growing and it will end in a flower, and the further growth will be by means of the axillary buds. The older flowers will be present at the apex, at the end, and the younger flowers will be at the base. Now the differences between the racemose and the cymose inflorescence. In the racemose inflorescence, the main axis will have unlimited growth. It keeps on growing, producing flowers laterally. Whereas in the cymose inflorescence, the main axis will have only limited growth. It will end in producing a flower. The flowers are arranged in acropetal succession in the racemos. That means the new flowers will be arising at the top, at the head region. So acropetal succession. Whereas in the cymos, the flowers are arranged in a basipetal succession. That means the new flowers will be produced at the base of the inflorescence. In racemos, the opening of the flower is centripetal. That means from the outer flower will be blooming first, then to the inner flowers in the centripetal pattern. Whereas in cymos, the opening of the flowers will be centrifugal. That means the center flower will be opening first, then it will be preceded by the next lateral flowers, and it will end in the last lateralmost flower. Usually the oldest flowers will be at the base of the inflorescence in the racemos, whereas the oldest flowers will be at the top of the inflorescence in the cymos. Now let us learn about the racemos first. Here the central axis of the inflorescence, that is the peduncle, it will possess the terminal bud, which is capable of growing continuously and producing flowers laterally, and this is called as racemos inflorescence. It is further divided into three according to the type of growth pattern of the main axis. The first type is called as main axis elongated. It will have the main peduncle elongated, and it is again classified into simple raceme, spike, catkin, spikelet, spadix and panicle. The second type is called as main axis shortened. So the main axis of the inflorescence will be shortened, the main peduncle will be shortened, and this is again classified into corymb and umbel. The third type is that main axis flattened or globose. So the main axis will not be growing straight elongated, but it will be flattened, and so it is called as head inflorescence. Let us see one by one. In the main axis elongated, the first type was simple raceme. So it is represented by the A diagrammatic representation. So in simple raceme, the inflorescence axis is unbranched and the main axis will bear the flowers in acropetal succession. That means the younger flowers will be arranged at the top, will be produced at the top of the inflorescence axis. Example, Rotularia retusa and mustard. Second type is called spike. Here in the same way, that means the older flowers will be at the bottom and the younger flowers at the top in the acropetal succession. The flowers are produced on the inflorescence axis, but the flowers are sessile. They will not have the pedicel like this, and so it is called a spike. Examples for spike is Acaeranthus. The third type is called as spikelet. Here, similar to this spike, so this inflorescence is with branched central axis. The central axis is branched like this, and the sessile flowers are formed in the acropetal succession on the axis. A pair of inflorescence bracts, which is called as glume, this is the glume, which are present at the base of the inflorescence, and each sessile flower has a lemma, which is called as bract. So every sessile flowers will have the lemma or the bract and pallia. This is the lemma and this is the pallia, which is called as the bracteoles. And here the tepals are reduced to colorless scaly leaves. So you cannot see the petals and the sepals. Instead of the tepals will be present. Each flower will have the stamen and the pistil only. So they will have the tepals, stamen and pistil. The fourth type is called as catkin or pendulous spike. Here the long axis will be drooping down. The drooping axis will bear the small unisexual or bisexual flowers, and it is called as ament. So it will be hanging from the branch of the plant or the tree. So like this. So example for this is Acalypha ispida. The next type is called as spadix. In the spadix, the inflorescence axis will become thick and fleshy central axis, and it will possess many unisexual flowers in the acropetal succession. So usually the female flowers are found towards the base and the male flowers will be at the top. So each inflorescence is covered by a brightly covered hard bract, which is called a spathe. This you can see in the Amorphophallus and Colocasia. The next type of raceme inflorescence is called as panicle, in which the main axis is long. branched raceme is called as panicle. So the main inflorescence axis will be branched in the acropetal succession, and each branch will act as the inflorescence to the main inflorescence axis, and so it is called as panicle or compound raceme or raceme of raceme. It can be also called as compound raceme or raceme of raceme. Example, Mangifera indica and neem. The next we have the main axis shortened. Here you can see the main axis will be shortened and the lateral branches will be elongated than the main axis. This is the second type of racemose inflorescence. In this, the first one is called as the corymb. So in corymb, an inflorescence with shorter pedicellate flowers will be placed at the top and the longer pedicellate flowers will be placed at the bottom, so that all the flowers will be in the same level and they form a convex or the flat topped raceme inflorescence. Example, Cecilpinia. This is the next inflorescence which is called the compound corymb, which is nothing but the branched corymb. So in compound corymb, each pedicel will be branched. The branched corymb is called as compound corymb. Example for this is cauliflower. The next type of inflorescence is called umbel. So this is what is called as umbel type. Here pedicellate flowers will be arising from a common point. They will not be arising from the different point as in the previous cases. They will be arising at a common point of the peduncle at the apex region. Example for this is Allium sepa. And here also compound umbel is seen. In compound umbel, it's a branched umbel, and each smaller unit is called as umbellate. This is one umbellate, this is one umbellate. Like that, many umbellate will be present in the compound umbel. Example for this is Docus carota and Coriandrum sativum, that is carrot and coriander. The third type of racemose inflorescence, that is main axis flattened. The main axis of the inflorescence is flattened like convex or concave or globose head. The head or the capitulum is either determinate or indeterminate, and it possesses group of sessile or subsessile flowers, and they will arise on the receptacle. They are often substandard by an involucre. Head inflorescence is a characteristic feature of Asteraceae family. All the Asteraceae family members will possess this head inflorescence, and some members of Rubiaceae and Mimosaceae also possess head inflorescence type. And here the torus will have two types of florets. The first floret is disc floret or the tubular floret. The second one is ray floret or ligulate floret. Based on the type of these florets which are present on the head or capitulum, they are classified into two types, that is homogamous head and heterogamous head. In the homogamous head will possess only single type of floret, either disc floret or ray floret. If that disc floret alone is present, example Benonia. If the ray florets alone are present, then example Lunea. In the heterogamous head, both the type of florets, both the disc and the ray florets will be present. Example for this is Helianthus and Tridax. The disc florets are present at the center of the head region, and they are tubular and they will be having bisexual flowers. Whereas the ray florets, which are found at the margin of the head, they are said to be ligulate and pistillate. They are unisexual flowers. The flower and the inflorescence are supported by the lateral appendages, which is called as bract. In sunflower, we can see a whorl of bract which will form a cup-like structure below the inflorescence. They will be similar to the calyx, but they are not the calyx. They are the whorl of bracts or the involucre. A group of bract present beneath the subunits of every inflorescence is called as involucre. Next we have the cymose inflorescence, in which the central axis will stop growing and it will end in a flower, and the further growth of the inflorescence will be by means of axillary buds, and so the older flowers will be at the top apex region and the younger flowers will be at the base. What are the different types of cymose inflorescence? There are four types, namely simple cyme, monochaceal cyme, simple dichaceum and polychaceal cyme. simple cyme. It is having determinate inflorescence axis consisting of a single flower, and it may be either terminal or axillary. Terminal in the case of Trillium grandiflorum, and it is axillary in the case of hibiscus. The next one is called as monochaceal cyme. So monochaceal cyme, it is again classified into helicoid and scorpioid. The main axis will end in a flower. So this is the main axis which will end in a flower, and from the two lateral bracts only one branch will grow further, and it may be either helicoid or scorpioid. If it is helicoid, the axis will develop only on one side and form a coiled structure like this. See, from the axis of this main flower, another pedicellate flower is produced, and from the axis of this pedicellate flower, another flower is produced, and from this another, and from this another, like that. In only one side it will be produced, and so it gets a coiled structure. Example, Hemilia and potato. Whereas in the case of scorpioid inflorescence, axis develop on alternate sides. So for example, if this is the main axis, from this right side if it is developing a flower, for this the left side it will develop, then other side it will develop the next flower, and so it often becomes a coiled structure. Example, heliotropium. The next type is called a simple dichasium. So this is what is simple dichasium. The central axis will end in a terminal flower. The further growth will be produced by the two lateral buds, and each cymose unit will consist of three flowers. One will be central and the two will be at the sides. This is what is called as true cyme. Example, jasminum. The next type is called as compound dichasium. Here the main axis of the flower will have the lateral branches, and main axis will end in a simple flower. The terminal old flower will develop lateral simple dichasium cyme on both the sides, and each compound dichasium consists of seven flowers. Example, clerodendron. A small simple dichasium is called as cymule. The next type is called as polychasium. In polychasium, which is otherwise called as multiparous, here the central axis will end in a flower. The lateral branches will again branch repeatedly in the similar pattern. Example for this is nerium. Next we have the mixed inflorescence, in which both the raceme and the cymose pattern will be in a mixed manner, and it is again of two types, namely thyrsus and verticillaster. The first thyrsus, it is a raceme of cyme in which the indefinite central axis will be present, and it will bear the lateral pedicellate cyme. So these are the cyme. You can see the top older flower and the side younger flowers. This is a cyme. So it will have many cyme which is borne on the indefinite central axis in the raceme manner. So it is a raceme of cymes. Example for this is Arcimum. The next type is called as verticillaster, in which the main axis will bear two opposite lateral sessile cyme. So they will have two sessile cyme in the opposite axis, and each of which will produce monochaceal scorpioid lateral branches. You know what is scorpioid? From the axle, from one axle of the pedicel, main pedicel, another flower will be developing, and if it is produced at the right side, means the next flower will be produced at the left side, then it is called a scorpioid. So it will have the monochaceal scorpioid lateral branches. So the flowers are crowded around the node. So this is the nodal region, and the flowers will be seen crowded around the node region. Example, Eucos. The final type is called a special inflorescence. Here they do not show any of the development pattern. They do not show raceme or cyme. So they are classified as a special type of inflorescence. And this is again classified into three types, namely cyathium, hypanthodium and synanthium. This is the cyathium inflorescence. And it consists of small unisexual flowers, and it is enclosed by a common involucre. This will mimic like a single flower, but it is a compound flower having many male and the female flowers. The male flower is represented only by the stamen, and the female flower is represented by the pistil. The male flower is arranged in a scorpioid manner, and the female flower is single and it is solitary. It is centrally located. So this is the female flower, and these are all male flowers which are represented only by the stamen. The cyathea may be actinomorphic as in the case of euphorbia, and zygomorphic in the case of pedilanthus. And nectar will be present in the involucre. The next special type of inflorescence is called hypanthodium. The best example would be fig fruit. Have you eaten fig fruit? Have you cut it and seen? So you can see the receptacle, which will be hollow inside and it will be globose in structure. It consists of only unisexual flowers. They are present on the inner wall of the receptacle. The receptacle will be closed, which will leave a small opening which is called as osteole on the top, and this osteole will be covered by a series of bracts. The male flowers will be present near to the osteole, and the female flowers and the neutral flowers will be found in a mixed manner from the middle to the below. So this is the structure of hypanthodium. The next special type of inflorescence is called a synanthium. The synanthium will have circular disc which will be fleshy, and it will have open receptacle. It will bear the pistillate flowers at the center and the staminate flowers at the periphery. The pistillate flowers are the female flowers and the staminate flowers are the male flowers, which will be present at the periphery. Example for this is Dostinia. Flower. What is a flower? A flower is a modified condensed shoot for reproduction. It consists of four whorls. Two are accessory whorls, which consist of calyx and corolla, and two essential whorls, namely andrecium and gynecium. The flower is said to be complete only when it contains all the four whorls. If it lacks even a single whorl, it is said to be incomplete flower. So these are the structures of the flower. This is the receptacle on which all the floral whorls are arranged. The stalk of the flower is called pedicel. The calyx is made up of sepal and the corolla is made up of petal. The petals are colored and the sepals are green in color. Andrecium consists of the stamens, which is made up of the filament and the anther. And the gynecium consists of stigma, style and ovary. The sex of the flower is determined by the presence and the absence of the andrecium and gynecium. If the flower contains both andrecium and gynecium, it is said to be perfect flower. If the flower contains only one of the essential whorls, either andrecium or gynecium, then it is said to be imperfect flower. If the flower possesses andrecium alone, it is called as male flower or staminate flower. If the flower possesses gynecium alone, it is called as female flower or pistillate flower. The sex of the plant is determined by the presence and the distribution of the flowers with different sexes. The plant is said to be hermaphrodite if it has the flowers which are bisexual. If the plant has bisexual flowers, then it is hermaphrodite. If both the male and the female flowers are present in the same plant like this, then it is called as monoecious. If the male and the female flowers are present on two different separate plants, then it is said to be dioecious. The condition in which the bisexual as well as the unisexual flowers, whether it is staminate or the pistillate flowers, are present on the same plant, then it is called as polygamous. So example for monoecious plant, coconut. Example for dioecious, Palmyra, and example for polygamous, it is Mangifera and Musa. Bisexual flowers are present in the hibiscus. It is hermaphrodite. Next we have flower symmetry. A flower is symmetrical when it can be divided into two equal halves at any plane running through the center of it. According to the symmetry, they are classified into actinomorphic and zygomorphic. The first type is called actinomorphic. Actinomorphic, the flower shows the mirror image when it is cut in any plane which runs through the center. So normally there are two or more planes of symmetry. Example, hibiscus. So hibiscus is actinomorphic. The next type is called zygomorphic. In zygomorphic, the flower can be divided into two equal halves only in one plane that runs through the center like this. Then it is called as zygomorphic. Example, pisum and bean. There are some flowers which are asymmetric. So these flowers cannot be divided into equal halves at any plane because the parts of the flowers are twisted. Example, Canna indica, Chebbarai. Arrangement of the accessory organs like perianth, which include petals, sepals and tepals. They may be arranged in cyclic or whorled. If all the floral parts are arranged in a definite whorls, then it is called a cyclic or whorled. Example, brassica. Brassica is muttacos. Second type is acyclic or spiral. Here the floral whorls are arranged in spiral manner along the elongated fleshy torus. Example, magnolia. The third type is spirocyclic. It is a combination of both. Some parts are in whorls, whereas the other parts are in spirals. Example, anona and polyalthea. Calyx. Calyx is the outermost whorl of the flower and it will protect the flower in the bud stage. It is normally green in color. Based on the fusion of the sepals, the calyx is classified into apocephalous and syncephalous. Apocephalous is otherwise called polycephalous, in which the sepals are free and the flower will have distinct sepals. Example, brassica anona. In syncephalous, the flowers will have united or fused sepals. Example, hibiscus. Based on the duration of the floral parts, the calyx can be classified into caducous or fugaceous, deciduous, persistent and acrescent. In caducous, the calyx will wither off or fall off during the early developmental stage of the flower. Example, papaver. In deciduous, the calyx will fall soon after the opening of the flower. This is the example, that is Nulumbo lotus. So calyx will wither off after blooming of the flower. Third one, persistent. The calyx will persist and continue to be along with the fruit and it forms a cup-shaped base for the fruit. Example, brinjal. You can see the brinjal calyx here. The fourth type is called acrescent. Here the calyx will persist and it grows along with the fruit and it will enclose the fruit either completely or partially. Example, pisalis. This is the pisalis. Now based on the shape of the calyx, they are classified. If the calyx is belt-shaped, then it is called as campanulate. If the fruiting calyx is urn-shaped, then it is called as arceolate. Example for this arceolate calyx is Withania. When the calyx is tube-like, as in the case of Datura, then it is known as tubular. Two-lipped calyx is present in Osimum. And sometimes calyx are colored and they are called as petaloid. Example, Saraka and Musanda. In Tridax, calyx is fine hair-like. The calyx is modified into hair-like structure called pappus. So here you can see the campanulate, that is bell-shaped pappus. The calyx is modified into pappus hair and Musanda, where the calyx is colored and they are petaloid. Next is corolla. Corolla is the most attractive part and plays a very important role in attracting the pollinators. And based on the fusion, it is again classified into apopetalous or polypetalous and synpetalous or camopetalous. If the petals are free and distinct, it is called apopetalous. Example, hibiscus. If the petals are fused, then it is called synpetalous or camopetalous. Example, datura. Now, perianth, what are perianth? So, perianth is the term given for homochlamydious flowers where the calyx and corolla of the flower is undifferentiated. They are not differentiated as distinct calyx and corolla. They will be similar and so they are termed as perianth. And the member of the perianth is called tepal. If the tepals are distinct, then it is called as apotepalous. If they are fused, then they are called as syntepalous. Apotepalous is present in Allium sativum, that is garlic, and syntepalous is seen in Allium sepa. So what is this lodicule? Lodicules are nothing but the reduced scale like perianth. Perianth, when it is reduced and it becomes scale like, then it is called as lodicule, and it is seen in the members of Poaceae family. So that is rice. Rice belong to Poaceae. Mode of arrangement of the sepals and the petals of the flower is called aestivation. The first one is called as valvate aestivation. In this, the margins of the tepals or the petals do not overlap, but they will be just touching each other like this. Then it is valvate aestivation. Example, calyx in the members of Malvaceae, Calotropis and Annona. Second type is called twisted aestivation. Twisted aestivation is otherwise called as convolute or contorted aestivation. Here, one margin of the petal or sepal will overlap on the other. So, all the petals will be arranged in such a way that one will overlap on other. Example for this is petals of China rose. The third one is called as imbricate aestivation. Here, the petals and the sepals irregularly overlap on each other. One member of the whorl is exterior and one member will be interior, and the rest of the three will be having one margin in and one margin outside. This is again classified into three types, that is ascendingly imbricate aestivation, quincunctial aestivation and vexillary aestivation. So this is ascendingly imbricate aestivation. The next one is quincunctial aestivation. In this, two petals are external. See, one, and this is second petal. Two petals will be external and the two petals will be internal. These two are internal. And one petal with one margin internal and another margin will be external. Example for this is Gova, calyx of Ipomoea, Catanthus, etc. The last type of aestivation is called as vexillary aestivation. It is a type of imbricate aestivation in which a large posterior petal will overlap two lateral petals, overlap both the margins of the two lateral petals. The lateral petal other margin will overlap anterior petals. So these two are the anterior petals and this is the large posterior petals. Example for this is pea and bean. Now let us learn the essential parts of the flower. First one is andrecium. Andrecium is the third whorl of the flower and it is a male reproductive organ of the flower. It is composed of stamens which is called as microsporophylls, and each stamen consists of three parts, namely the filament, anther and the connective tissue. The upper swollen part with the microsporangia is called as anther. The stalk of the stamen is called as filament and the tissue connecting the anther with the filament is called as the connective tissue. Anthers typically contains two compartments, namely theca. In singular, it is called theca. So each theca consists of two microsporangia and these two microsporangia fuse to form a locule. When the stamens are sterile, they are called as staminodes. Example, cassia. Stamens are said to be distinct when the stamens do not fuse with each other. If the stamens do not fuse with other parts of the flower, then it is called as free. So, the flower which is having the free and the distinct stamen is said to be apostemonous. Now, according to the fusion of the stamens, they are called as conation and adnation. The stamens of a flower fuse among themselves, it is called as conation. If the stamens fuse with the other parts of the flower, it is called as adnation. So conation is again divided into three types. That is, fusion of the stamens among themselves is divided into three types, namely Adelphi, Syngenesius and Synandrus. In Adelphi, the filaments connate into one or more bundles, but the anthers will be free. This type Adelphi is again classified into monodelphus, diadelphus and polyadelphus. When the filaments of the stamens connate into single bundle like this, then it is said to be monodelphus. Example, Malvaceae. Malvaceae family, this is hibiscus. Second is diadelphus. When the filaments of the stamen connate into two bundles like this, one bundle and this is the second bundle, then it is said to be diadelphus. Example, Fabaceae family, pea plant and clitoria. Third one, polyadelphus. When the filaments connate into many bundles like this, example, citrus and bombax. What is syngenesious? In syngenesious, the anthers will be joining together. They will connate together, anthers connate, but the filaments will be free like this. Then it is said to be syngenesious. Example, Asteraceae family. In synandrous, the filaments and the anthers are completely fused. The whole andricium will be fused together. Example, Coccinea. What is adnation? Adnation refers to the fusion of the stamens with the other floral parts. It is again classified into epipetalous, episepalous, gynostigium and pollinium. In episepalous, the stamens will be joined with the adnate to the sepals. Example, Grevillea, silver oak. In epitepalous, the stamens are adnate to tepals. Example, asparagus. In gynostigium, the stamen and the stigma will be joined together and it is called as gynostigium. Example, Calotropis and Orchidaceae family. Pollinium, the pollen grains are fused together into a single mass. Example, Calotropis. Based on the arrangement of the stamen, they are classified into didynamous, tetradynamous and heterostemonous. Didynamous, four stamens of which two stamen will have long filament and two stamen will have short filament. Example, Osimum. In the tetradynamous, out of the six stamens, four will be having long filaments and two will have the short filament. Then it is called as tetradynamous. Example, Brassica. In heterostemonous, the stamens are of different length. They will not be having the same length of the filament. They will be of different length, but they will be present in the same flower. Example, Cassia. Now, based on the anthers, there are two types of anthers and they are named as monothecal and dithecal. If the anther has got only one lobe with two microsporangia, they are in the kidney shape in cross section. So they will be in the kidney shape in cross section and it is called as monothecal. Example, Malvaceae family. The second one is called dithecal. They will have two lobes with four microsporangia and the cross section of this anther will be butterfly shaped. Example, Solanaceae. Based on the anther attachment, the andricium is classified into four types. They are, first one, basi fixed. It is otherwise called as innate. Here, the base of the anther is attached to the tip of the filament. Example, Datura. Dorsi fixed. The apex of the filament is attached to the dorsal side of the anther. Then it is dorsi fixed. Example, Hibiscus. The third type is called versatile. Here the filament will be attached to the midpoint of the anther. The anther will be swinging at the point of attachment and this is seen in grasses. The fourth type is called adnate. Here the filament will be continued from the base to the apex of the anther like this. Then it is called as adnate. Example, Nilambo.